This week on Cracked Science, health secrets doctors don't want you to know because they're not true. Hey, this is Jonathan Jerry, and you're watching Cracked Science, the bi-weekly show from the McGill Office for Science and Society that separates sense from nonsense on the scientific stage. Tell me, does this sound familiar?
You'll discover that this plant works miracles on many conditions, including cancer, chronic pain, epilepsy, autoimmune diseases like arthritis and MS, and much more. These diseases are normally treated with expensive pharmaceuticals that have devastating side effects. But as we will show you, these conditions have been found to go into remission when treated with this God-given plant.
Imagine you are seriously ill and you're dissatisfied with the medical treatments you're receiving. A video like this, and there are tons of them on YouTube, will begin to look very appealing. But all too often, these videos show pretty striking signs that what you are being sold is hope in a jar. Unless you're shopping at Sephora, in which case you may be buying an actual product called Hope in a Jar, and it better give you an all-day glow for the price you're paying. But getting back to the video, what we just watched is a short clip from a 7-plus-hour series called The Sacred Plant. We are teased that a miraculous plant exists that can cure everything, but Big Pharma doesn't want you to have it. Spoiler alert, it's cannabis. Now, we could do a whole episode about what cannabis has proven it can do, besides reassuring you that the climax of the OA makes perfect sense. Seriously, what was that? Now, marijuana and its compounds have been shown to be effective against chronic pain and the nausea that accompanies chemotherapy. There's some evidence that it can help with sleep and with the subjective symptoms of multiple sclerosis, but that's pretty much it. Oh, also, if you have a specific form of childhood epilepsy that is drug-resistant, a certain compound found in cannabis helps reduce the number of seizures you get. Store that away for now, as we'll return to this later. But if you listen to the people interviewed on The Sacred Plant, you would think cannabis can not only cure every disease facing humanity, but can actually turn the Middle East into a peaceful paradise and can prevent Skynet from taking over the world. Basically, if you plucked hippies from the 1960s and gave them digital cameras, you would get this. So let's use The Sacred Plant as a case study of the kinds of arguments that may look good on their surface, but that actually aren't convincing at all, starting with this ancient gem.
This has been around for thousands of years, and I think that a lot of people don't realize that.
This is known as the appeal to antiquity. Some people have taken the idea of rose-tinted glasses way more seriously than I have, and believe that our ancestors lived until 150 years in perfect health and had flying cars like some sort of pot-smoking Atlantis utopia. First off, do you know what the life expectancy at birth in the United States was in 1900? About 47 years of age. And the top three causes of death back then were pneumonia, the flu, and tuberculosis. Second, just because something has been used for hundreds of years doesn't make it an effective treatment. Bloodletting was practiced for a long time as it was inspired by menstruation and the idea that it purged women of their bad humors. Look, the joke writes itself, I'm not going to make it, but suffice to say that people can be wrong for a long period of time. Case in point, slavery. But this appeal to antiquity and similar arguments like the appeal to nature require you to pay attention when you watch a video like this because they tend to be used as delicate spices. The meat of the course, however, consists of these.
So I thought, well, what the heck? I put the CBD on there. Within 2 days, it was gone. Just gone. So, number one, I'm a firm believer in it. Number two, it's something that needs to get out to the world. It needs to get out to the world.
Anecdotes are fantastic sales tools because the human brain responds to stories like it's emotional cocaine. We love narratives of David versus Goliath, of ordinary mothers fighting big corporations and terrible diseases and winning in the end. The problem with anecdotes is that they are not reliable forms of evidence. And I'm not saying that because I'm a stuck-up scientist who lost his humanity in grad school. Take Andrew, for example. He gives a beautiful testimonial in part 4 of The Sacred Plant that will reveal just what is wrong with using anecdotes to convince people. He started having seizures, got a brain scan, and was told he had a type of brain tumor known as anaplastic astrocytoma. He reports they operated on him and removed 99% of the tumor, following which he was submitted to high-dose radiotherapy and chemotherapy. He also started using a cannabis vaporizer. 5 years after his diagnosis, Andrew is still alive, and his doctor tells him to keep doing what you're doing. Andrew credits in large part the cannabis. Now, we need to ask ourselves, what was his prognosis? It turns out to be complicated because anaplastic astrocytoma has different variants depending on which gene is mutated, and you do better depending on which variant you have. But the American Brain Tumor Association and the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada both report a median survival of 2 to 3 years. That does not mean you are dead after 3 years. It means half of the people are dead after 2 to 3 years, but also that half are still alive. The fact that Andrew is still alive at 5 years is not a miracle, and it's probably in large part thanks to the medical interventions he had done and not the cannabis. But it is tempting to assign our salvation to the all-natural thing we chose, and which didn't result in a scar, hair loss, or nausea. If instead of cannabis, Andrew had gone gluten-free, would we similarly applaud his new diet as a cancer cure? What if he started washing his hair with Goop shampoo used by indigenous women for centuries? And congratulations on noticing the appeal to antiquity. When do we decide that something definitely caused a tumor to shrink? And keep in mind that these videos don't show you the people who took cannabis and didn't get better. These emotional stories, like Andrew's and others involving mothers and children, which were chosen because they had positive outcomes, they still require one more kicker, one more ingredient designed to provoke anger and to draw a line in the sand between the good guys and the bad guys.
This information has been hidden from you, me, and everyone around the world for decades, and that stops today.
In their crudest form, medical conspiracy theories can look like this popular meme of a woman who can seemingly peel off her wrinkles like saran wrap. The trick costs a little more than $5. A Photoshop license is now about $30 a month if you pay month to month. Conspiracy theories are appealing to our brain, especially if we are predisposed to be anti-establishment. They may simplify reality, and they also help us cope with injustices. If someone you are close with has ever been diagnosed with a terminal illness, you remember how you felt. Why? Why him? Why her? Why can't medicine help them? You feel cheated, and that's when those conspiracy theories become particularly tempting. In The Sacred Plant, we are told that the medical establishment is opposed to cannabis for a very simple reason.
Because they're only interested in drugs and therapies that can be patented that will generate high profits. So the industry turns a blind eye to anything that's natural and to anything that's non-toxic.
You can't patent cannabis, so Big Pharma doesn't want to study it. Except that it does, and it has. Remember that particular childhood epilepsy I mentioned earlier for which cannabis can help? Well, the trial that showed that was funded by GW Pharmaceuticals. It used an oral solution called Epidiolex, which is made up of one of the many chemicals found in cannabis, cannabidiol. Now, there are genuine legal hurdles to using and even just researching medicinal marijuana, but to claim that Big Pharma doesn't care about it is simply a lie. But it is an appealing lie because it demonizes the pharmaceutical industry and gives you someone to blame. Look, there are many valid reasons to be critical of the pharmaceutical industry. Ben Goldacre wrote an impressive tome detailing all of them. But we don't need to invent fake ones. Conspiracy thinking, appeals to nature and antiquity, and anecdotal evidence, those are the secrets they don't want you to know, the people selling you hope in a vaporizer. They don't want you to pick up on these tricks the same way that the talker at a carnival doesn't want you to get too close to the half-man, half-orangutan, lest the trickery be revealed. But you can think of these tips as superpowers. Now that you have them, you'll be more powerful when you're exposed to the slimy manipulations of the super quacks. So, let's all gather around the table, dust off our capes, and revel in our newfound superpowers by playing Bad Argument Bingo.
I had noticed that times that I had the most pain and I would use cannabis to control that, I was able to get off of antibiotics.
Now I understand the true medical potential of this sacred plant and how it could threaten the multi-billion dollar market for pharmaceutical prescriptions. You'll discover that this plant works miracles.
Thank you for being here and for being you. It takes an extraordinary person to search for solutions beyond the conventional medical model.
I had a certain amount of skepticism, but the more that I've been doing this,
the drugs don't treat the root cause of the problem. They treat a symptom, they mask a symptom.
Healing comes from within, that we have this incredible inner pharmacy.
Our modern medical system, which they call evidence-based medicine, is really truly patent-based, profit-based medicine.
My recommendation this week is specifically for our bilingual audience. It's a French language book called Le Pharmacien 3, La Bible des arguments qui n'ont pas d'allure. Olivier Bernard is a pharmacist and science communicator who got fed up with the bad arguments I exposed in this video and who decided to make a book about it. It's teeming with cartoons, geek humor, and is extremely accessible. No university diploma required. Just an FYI, if you're watching this video on Dr. Joe's Facebook page, come check us out on YouTube. Our OSS channel has more videos like this one, interviews and content from Dr. Joe himself. Go to YouTube and type in Separating Sense from Nonsense, then click the subscribe button. Our office is very active, so find us on whichever social media platform you prefer, Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram. And don't forget our website at mcgill.ca/OSS. You can also follow me on Twitter at Cracked Science, and I will see you 2 weeks from now.